All right, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the South County Board of Oversight. Chair Robert Ahern will not be attending this evening because of a previous engagement. I guess, because I'm the clerk, we have to figure out who the vice chair is at some point. But I'll run the meeting, I guess, tonight, and we'll move this forward. So first thing up tonight is director's report.
It's a long one.
Well, I thought it was really nice.
Oh, well, thanks. Take one, pass it on.
Wait.
So, starting from the top, we've actually seen the two busiest months since our inception. 95 runs in October, 93 in September. Not sure what to attribute that to other than normal ebb and flow slash people knowing that we exist and calling us instead of driving themselves to the hospital. We did document 4 intercepts in October, which is nice to be able to provide that service and extra revenue, but only 4, so it's really not playing a part in that large uptick. But despite that large uptick, we're still doing some great stuff. We had a attempted chemical suicide recently in Sunderland, which is something that emergency responders have been training for quite some time. It's when somebody tries to commit suicide by mixing 2 chemicals inside of their car, and it creates a chemical reaction and a deadly toxic gas. So it's something that it's so dangerous to responders that at least once a year we do in-service trainings on it. And we had one in Sunderland. The individual actually survived because at the last minute he exited the car right as he was starting to create the reaction. So,
question.
Yeah.
I know a lot of the textbooks, they say that a lot of times when this happens, the person will put a note on a window.
Yes.
For the EMS. Did that happen?
I believe it did. I haven't heard the specific report yet. He is the one who called 911.
Okay.
And told the dispatcher what he had done and what had happened. But what Mr. Stone is referring to is that there's actually instructions online in regards to this type of suicide that directs the people who are predicting it to actually leave a note on the car warning responders, warning the general public to call the hazmat team and things like that. So I guess a particular conscientious method of suicide. But we responded, and not only did we provide initial care for the individual, but we also stayed on scene for the regional hazmat team. They require an ambulance on scene while they suit up and decontaminate. So we were there for that. And Amherst called us again. They had another large scale incident. I'm sure you've seen in the news that Amherst staffing is they're clamoring for more staff. And anytime they have a major incident, they don't have enough people to cover all the last calls in town. So for second time or third time now, Amherst has called South County EMS, and we were able to muster a second ambulance and actually provide them with EMS coverage. So happy to do that.
That's wonderful, Zach.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. And you know, I said it before, I'll say it again, it really speaks highly of our department that if they feel comfortable to call us, and that we're able to do that. So
yeah.
Kind of segueing into the good work we're doing, or staying on the track rather, I've included the text from a Sunderland police officer that I personally received on my cell phone after this incident. We had a patient go into cardiac arrest while EMS was there. I can't recall the initial complaint that the person had, but we responded along with Sunderland Fire, and the police officer was there. And while our staff was caring for the patient, they went into cardiac arrest, and our staff was able to kind of transition modes. They were in the middle of extricating the patient at that moment, so they continued to do that. They engaged Sunderland Fire. They're a great team. They know what they're doing. And this officer in particular, relatively new to emergency services, had never experienced this type of situation before, and was utilized and was so taken aback at the professionalism of everybody, he decided to reach out to me. So I guess for the record, I'll read it out loud. This is cut and paste from him. All I did was remove the location of the patient's name, but he said, "Hey, I just wanted to pass along the message that your people are the utmost professional and sympathetic public safety personnel that I've ever worked with, and that makes me truly honored to work alongside them every single day. The woman who coded yesterday," coded is a term we use for cardiac arrest, "Gary and Alicia," they're both paramedics with South County, "as well as Sunderland Fire Department's ability to work with one another hand in hand and communicate during what most people would think is a stressful situation was something every public safety agency should have seen and should strive to accomplish. No one stepped on anyone's toes, and if someone needed something, someone stepped in to help out." And he concludes by saying, "There's no doubt in my mind that if I was lying in the middle of the road, those are the individuals I want working on me to try to save my life. Of course, yesterday wasn't the outcome anyone hoped for, but absolutely proud of your staff. They do an amazing job each and every day, and being able to somewhat sit back and watch them do what they do best was completely extraordinary." We're not in the business for praise, but it's nice to kind of get things in writing and share those thoughts. So,
Zach, just because I don't really know, do you have a procedure for follow-up in these kind of situations where people, you're just doing a psychological check?
For the person, yes, actually, we do, and for this particular case, we actually had a debrief where we address that and we talk to the staff and we make sure that...
Is there anything that we should be doing as part of that procedure, or do you feel like you have a...
I think we're all set. We have a really robust program in place between regional EMS and our employee assistance program.
Okay. Would you just please let us know if that is not the case or you need further things? So I think that was very important. We're just coming across more and more stuff, and I don't know if it's just because of the overdoses and stuff like that. And I just, our people to get stressed out.
Yeah, of course.
They do have teams that they put together who can actually come out and...
I just want to make sure we're availing ourselves of whatever, mm-hmm. and that is not, in my mind, a cost consideration. That's part
right.
of the job,
yeah,
and we need to look out for our people. So just, I don't know if you need more, but I want to make sure that you know that we are here to support you.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much.
I'd also like to chime in there that I believe that our medical coverage would also provide certain types of psychological, assistance.
The benefits of the town provides, the employee assistance program, and Western Mass EMS, critical incident stress debriefing team, and all those resources. Yeah, absolutely.
The one thing, Zach, in this the letter, and I'd like to, one of the challenges of having a regional of anything is that you work across so many town lines and command lines. And a note like this showing, they talk about the Sunderland Fire Department today, but I'm sure you could talk about Deerfield and Whiteley at the same time. It appears that the integration between South County EMS and our local each individual fire departments and police departments is going very well. Mm-hmm. And I think that reflects very highly on you and your staff. So good job.
Oh, thanks. I would tend to say the exact same thing, but it's nice to hear from somebody actually in another department.
It's good. When I read the report and I saw this, I just know how hard it is to because you're working with so many different people,
right.
and so many you're working with three different fire chiefs, three different police chiefs, and different crews, and to have this written this way speaks volumes about what's going on in our three towns, and our residents should be proud of all these departments working this way.
I agree.
All right. This is going to surely stir some debate, I'm sure. Our A2 impact shift, which is, we identify the times during the day which we have the most calls. More calls than we can handle with just our one ambulance. So we added that impact shift from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. And up until that point, we added them in springtime, end of winter. That person, actually, they're a local EMT or call staff, and they come to the South Deerfield Fire Station, and A2 is with them. And actually what their role is is to actually staff the primary ambulance. This does a couple of things. It keeps that local EMT, that per diem staff member, engaged, doing calls, and active on the department. It also frees up one of the full-time people that was scheduled that day to do other duties, administrative, outreach, things like that, so they're not interrupted when the first call comes out. And then if we have a second call, then they respond. We have an obligation to keep the ambulance within a certain temperature range, and that's been identified as 50 degrees to 85 degrees Fahrenheit. This is a standard temperature range, and it's a couple reasons. One is just for patient comfort, but also for the medications. In order for them to maintain their efficacy, they have to be within that range. During the relatively mild summer this year, not an issue. Our staff monitors those temperatures, and it's not a deal breaker. Going into winter, though, when the ambient temperatures are going to fall out of that range, it means that that vehicle no longer can just sit outside. So what do we do? There's three solutions to this problem that we can enact right now. None of them are perfect, each with their own individual concerns. But I sent out a directive earlier in the week that moving forward, any day that the ambient temperature is going to fall out of that range and we're worried that the ambulance is going to dip below that 50 degree mark, that impact shift person will still report for duty at the South Deerfield Fire Station, but A2 will remain in the Sunderland Fire Station in the climate control bay. That keeps everybody together. That keeps us in the least agreed space for office and rest and things like that. And also makes that second personnel immediately available for the high acuity calls where we're required to respond with additional personnel. So the downside of it is now we've got staff traveling between stations. So if the first crew comes out, they don't need that additional staff. That means that impact person is going to have to drive to the Sunderland Fire Station. Right now, that would have to be in their personal vehicle. If it's to respond to pick up the second ambulance in an emergency, we're now asking them to drive to the Sunderland Fire Station under that stress or an emergency capacity in their personal vehicle. So, and we're also going to see an increase in response times for that second ambulance if we have to respond to another station. Not ideal, but it seems to be the best option available to us right now, short of being able to put everybody in one place.
Well, why wouldn't that person just be with the ambulance in Sunderland?
So as I said, that we only have, for multiple reasons, one is our office is at the South Deerfield Fire Station. Both practically, that's where all of our equipment and our computers and everything is. Also, technically, our lease doesn't give us access to office space and things elsewhere. We only lease the office space. But also making that person immediately available for those high acuity calls.
Zach, I did talk to Kevin after I read your report.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't sorted out everything, but I think we could offer space at the highway garage so that the ambulance could be there when it gets too cold. And so instead of coming all the way down to Sunderland and then coming back up, you could be just have to go to the highway garage.
Okay. I'd have to weigh that. I mean, it's not an obvious yes on that because there's either way the ambulance is someplace else. And,
I know. I'll continue to work on it. But I read your report and I was taking the ICS 300 classes Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, so I wasn't able to do any kind of phone calling. Literally there was no time.
Yeah, and this is one of those things that snuck up on me, you know. I was just enjoying the summer, and then all of a sudden it starts getting cold, and I realized that we're going to have to find a solution for this. So, yeah, I'm sure we can figure something out.
What did you do last year?
We didn't have the impact shifts.
Oh, you didn't?
Nope.
While we're on that, I mean, Whately would allow them to park the ambulance at the library building as well, which they could take both the second and third ambulance, put them both in the same building, and you know, it would make it easier for them to do their routine maintenance and inventory and stuff like that, and it wouldn't be that long of a run from South Deerfield Station to get there either.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that is an option as well.
Okay. Thank you. You know, I'm going to have to, I'll have to look at all these.
It's good to have options.
Yeah, absolutely. I love options. You know, this directive aside, you may very well still see, and probably will see, a two over at the South Deerfield Fire Station temporarily as our crews are doing truck checks and things like that. Yeah. But just know that, you know, it's within this this directive, so. All right.
Trevor, do you have any comments on that?
No, I think it's good that, you know, that there are these other options available, and I'm sure Zach will have to try and figure out which is the best one. We'd love to have you all in one spot. But, you know, that is an interesting thought of having both in either in Waitley or, you know, I don't know if we can fit. Can we fit two in the highway garage, or we don't have room for one?
Oh, no, I just called Kevin in.
Just to ask, as an emergency, what could we do?
Yeah, I was going to look at the I just didn't have a chance, and I don't know, you know, do we want to step into this right now, but I do want to say that Deerfield Academy has agreed to make a donation and meet the needs of the service, and so hopefully this is going to happen relatively soon, and but, you know, I don't know if it's going to happen before the temperatures get to be an issue.
Okay, so Kip, do you have thoughts? On the housing right now, or you just want to see how it plays out?
Yeah, see how it works out. You know, Jack, you know,
I think Jack should make the decision based on what he has.
All right, so can I get a motion? I know we have a MOU that describes where things are kept and everything, but during this impact shift, could I entertain a motion that we allow, if Zach comes up with a plan to keep the ambulances together or closer together during this impact, have a motion to allow Zach to do that, and then we can vote at our next meeting to support the decision.
Absolutely. I'll make that motion.
Yeah. Okay, we have a motion made.
I'll second.
And we have a second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Zach, 5-0, please.
Ready, left.
Zach, thanks for bringing that to our attention.
Pleasure.
Yeah, I'm sorry that I just didn't have time to address other solutions.
Sorry, let me just finish this thought here in a minute. Okay. Staffing. Through interviews, ranking, all that, I've identified a great candidate to fill that full-time slot, and that person is very much excited. The next step would be to, presuming the board here has no issues, bring it to the personnel committee in Deerfield for approval of the grade, and then the Deerfield Select Board.
So we need to make a motion with that name to forward it to the town of Deerfield for consideration, right?
Yes, I guess that
we'd make a motion as a board of oversight, and then we would forward that to the town of Deerfield to follow through on their procedures.
Yeah, just maybe Zach could just add in the salary that we are supporting the salary.
Just to be competitive and to, you know, we're looking at what's already been determined as the fair rate, which is like the step six range.
Okay.
So
just put, that should be part of the motion, so that the board of oversight's recommendation includes the competitive rate of, or the going rate of whatever it is, Zach, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Six.
Do I make the motion?
No, give us a name.
Oh, okay.
I didn't care if it's a motion.
Sure, it's Teresa Emerson.
Okay, so I make the motion that we forward to the Deerfield Selectman, Teresa Emerson, at what grade is it?
Grade six.
Grade three, step six on the EMS classification compensation scale.
Yes. Okay, thank you, Zach.
Do we have a motion? Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing no discussion, all those in favor of recommending Teresa, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Zach, 5-0.
Roger that, thank you.
Zach, that just gets you kind of back to where, kind of where you were, right? But reading your report, it looks like you're also looking.
Okay.
You're still short.
Yeah, well, so I, you know, that's, there's been some scuttlebutt recently about our overtime expenditures. The short of the long of it is our salary line items include full-time staff with allocations for overtime and part-time per diem staff to backfill in their absence. And taken together, we're right where we should be for this place in the year. So we've spent more in overtime recently, but it hasn't put us over budget for that line item. The reason we've seen increased overtime recently is, one, this open full-time slot has put a large burden on our per diem staff, and also we had a full-time person out on leave for a month. So we saw the uptick, we've already seen it come back down, so I'm confident that this isn't some crisis we've fallen into and we won't get out of.
All right, if the person that we just recommended, and I don't have the past minutes with me, but if the person that we just recommended is voted upon and becomes a member of the staff, how many employees would that make?
9, including myself.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
I saw it written in here there the number 8, and I just said, boy, I thought we had said there was, we had.
Yeah, so I can segue into that and kind of explain what that number means.
Can do you have a sense of when this person can start?
As quickly as humanly possible.
So she doesn't have another job that she needs to leave.
She does, and that would be part of, I mean, as far as this process goes, there's still so many steps. I wasn't going to set a date.
Well, the only thought that I had was it's the holiday season, and, you know, by my lay understanding, holiday season tends to increase ambulance runs at times. Mm-hmm. And it might, having her start sooner rather than later will minimize the overtime.
Correct.
Cost needs.
Yep.
You guys have a meeting.
Actually, we have a meeting Monday.
But you can't do that.
It's not on the agenda, but it could be.
Well, you got a forward.
Business not anticipated, and what has happened in multiple times, and this we would have to discuss this at our selectmen's meeting, but it has already shown that every EMT that paramedic that we're hiring at this grade. Step 6. So to go through the personnel committee is going to cost money to wait for their next meeting in a couple weeks. So, you know, they'll have to meet in December. I think it's the second. Is it the second Monday or the third Monday of the month? I'm not sure.
I've got one scheduled for
the second.
The 5th, the 21st, which is this upcoming Monday, and then 2 weeks later is the 5th.
Well, that's our meeting.
Personnel committee meeting is
called. Oh, they're going to have a meeting on the 21st?
I have it in my calendar. I don't know.
Well, then we can go to them, and then we can vote on that the same night. But what I was going to say is we have to discuss it as a select board, but we have had established that the pay rate at grade 1 is not competitive, and every paramedic that has been hired at this grade 6, so it's not unusual.
Mm-hmm.
So we might, to save money, because that's what we want to do, is to save money and save stress on the service and people. I mean, I worry about burnout of our people that are doing so much overtime. So maybe the select board at that point would decide that we would just go forward without a personnel recommendation. But I will call the personnel committee and verify that they have a meeting on the 21st. Okay.
All right, thank you.
I just didn't think it was that late in the month. I thought it was already.
It's already the 17th, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I thought it was already gone by. But I'll figure out if it will save us overtime, it saves money for everybody. So
sure.
Why wouldn't we do this?
Yeah.
Just for your information, Carolyn, they just had them Monday night.
That's why I don't know why, I didn't realize that they were going to have another one on the 21st.
I'm looking at my calendar, I put that in a while ago. That should be double checked because
it's just. But I hate to have you wait for a whole nother month. I mean, I don't want you to wait for another month.
I know, yeah, right, I know.
So.
Well, the sooner rather than later.
Yeah, the select board is meeting on Monday, so, you know, I'll bring it up as business. And see what everyone thinks. We just can't discuss it right now. Not an agenda item.
All right, so the question about the staff, this is. Here's how South County EMS works. We staff one ambulance 24/7, and we do that with 8 full-time people. That actually leaves an 8-hour gap every week because those people can't cover the full, right? And then that's our 8 full-time on-duty personnel. I do an administrative shift 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., which doubles up with the impact shift. So that gives us that second ambulance availability and for intercepts and high acuity calls and things like that.
Because that's your highest volume.
Correct, yeah. So that's how we work. But that means that we actually have, with those 8 full-time people, the second somebody's sick, somebody's at training, somebody's on leave, whatever, vacation, we're in scramble mode. Because on a larger department, the difference between having 3 ambulances and 2.5 ambulances one day, you can absorb. Us, it's either one ambulance or no ambulance. So we try to backfill, we plan ahead, we schedule 8 weeks out with our per diem and call staff, and we have a very robust per diem and call staff, and they really rise up to the challenge, which is great. We have amazing staff. They're professionals, they have full-time jobs elsewhere, and this overtime has come into play where we wheel and deal a lot. So with that extra 80 hours a week recently that we have vacant with the full-time slot and all that other stuff. Anything we can't plan ahead for, we try to 8 weeks out, right? And then that day comes around, it's like, hey, you know, how about you stay over, you know, stay a couple hours at the end of your shift, you know, you'll work a 12 instead of an 8, and then I'll have somebody else come in and I'll get you out of your shift at the end of the week. And so we're wheeling and dealing to keep our lights on, and then by the end of the week, it's like, we've called everybody, nobody's available, everybody's got a day job, so then we're going out to overtime once none of our per diems are available. When you factor in our full-time staff and in-service training, vacations, holidays, sick time, and that those 8-hour shifts that are unfilled, we're actually behind the 8 ball at least 60 hours a week on average. If this was an office, you'd hire another person. And then
we did.
Right, well, it would average out, right? And things like that. It's not that simple in EMS, because I don't know when I'm going to need them, right? I don't know when that person's going to get sick until the last moment. So that makes it more difficult. The question was asked, has been bandied about, would it make sense to add more staff? And what you see here is just an answer to that question. I ran the numbers, I did the math, and tried to figure out what that would look like. How would you get the most bang for the buck, and what would it cost us? And that's the answer here. Basically, you know, the question that the last meeting was talked about clerical staff. The department our size normally would have clerical staff. A lot of those duties now are shared amongst the full-time staff, and I don't think it would make sense for us to hire just a straight clerical person. So the idea was, if there were to be an extra person, you increase capacity within the system. In their downtime, they would be doing those clerical duties, so it'd be double duty. Be a EMT slash, you know, clerical thing, and part of their rotation would be something standard like Sunday through Friday during a day shift to be able to provide for those early morning sick call-outs and also those open shifts on Sunday, but also that their schedule would be flexible, and that would be part of the understanding that we don't have anybody to fill later in the week, so instead of coming in Thursday morning, we're actually going to have you work the overnight or something like that. This is just a preliminary look at what that would kind of look like, but that's the answer to that hypothetical question.
So Zach, I sat down with you and I was rushed, so I wasn't able to absorb all of this. So this new person would be a full-time person with benefits, right?
Yes, yeah, okay. Would be the idea.
So did the $5,000 include the benefits?
No, the $5,000 only includes the increase in salary. I calculate the benefit costs per full-time person. Let me see if I can find my notes.
It was my fault. I was rushed, so I didn't ask you to.
Yeah,
I couldn't get into it a lot with you. I was just checking on other stuff.
You can see what I'm dealing with here. The full-time benefit cost would probably add another like $18,000 to the bottom line of the budget, depending on...
For this year.
No,
annually.
Annually.
This is annual. Like kind of an average worst-case scenario. Barbara and I disagree on our benefit costs. The number I calculated for this past budget cycle was a lot higher than what she had. So we're still trying to meet on why my numbers are so different than hers.
Yeah, I haven't sorted that out.
Yeah.
The big variable to that is if you hire a single person or you hire a married person that has three kids.
Absolutely.
And they choose that, you know, that could be a huge difference.
So right, it's but you can't hire based. You can't hire based on that.
Well, I understand that, but I mean, that's a big variable that you can't really answer.
Right, right.
The one thing, Zach, and I'd like to add, one, I'm tired of running this group by hearing about stuff that's being said in the background. To hell with them. I want you to stop listening to them. I want you to be, personally, I want you to be the director. Rumors, we're done with, in my opinion. I'm sorry, but I'm done with rumors.
Tom, that's why we're here.
I understand, no.
We're ending it.
That's right, that's what I'm trying
to
say.
We're getting information, we have information.
And that's what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
That's what I'm trying to say. I don't want you to run the department by rumors. Police department, don't run by rumors. Fire department, don't run by rumors. We're not going to run by rumors. The second thing, we're a new organization. What I'd like to see, instead of talking about necessarily that in hypothetical right now, and about adding people, it's November. Zach is starting on FY 18 or 17 budget right now.
18.
That's where we need to see those numbers. So what I like to see is that you start saying, okay, we ran this year, this is what happened with overtime, this is what the final result was, this is what we have for historical, for sick people, stuff like that. This is what we have to do to keep our budget thing. And at the same time, I don't want you to deal with rumors. I don't want to deal with maybe a potential once or twice situation.
I don't want to interrupt too much, but I want to just say, Zach is responding to me.
Oh, no, I know.
Harassing him on I mean, I was worried, looking at the overtime, and I was just thinking, oh my gosh, we're going to burn out our people. And oh my gosh, shouldn't we hire another person?
And we may.
And we may, but I don't understand, but I just want to, before you...
Just the opposite. I'm tired, and I think Kip and Trevor and the other members of the committee, I'm tired of hearing the stuff in the background while he's floating around.
But I'm not sure what your response was to, because he didn't really say, well, I'm doing this because of that, you know?
No, I'm just clarifying that he is responding to my request. As we're analyzing the payroll, and how do we adjust? Because I was worried the first few payrolls, the overtime was getting really high, and then we, had this huge overtime blip. But as Zach explained, it was because AJ was out for a month, and then, we were down a person, and so. I was just saying, well, let's take this opportunity because we have to get back on track. Look at some of this, staffing changes and stuff. So I just want you to know that that's what he's responding to, not.
Well, when we first started the conversation, I was talking about rumors and innuendo and stuff like that.
Oh,
that's how we started the conversation.
Oh, Well, I think he was responding to me, right, Zach?
Yes, I mean, it was the question about...
I'm not being mad, I'm just trying to reassure, I want Zach to be, Zach is our director, and there's no other, the police department doesn't have this, the police department's budget's not picked apart monthly.
Oh, no, I did the same.
You know what I mean? But I mean, in a public...
You do the same with the police department?
I do the same, yes. I analyze their, I mean...
God help John. No, I'm sorry.
No, this is what we do, Jonathan. We know where we are.
Kind of been a little levity to it there on the first.
I spent 45 minutes with him, gave him information on why he should buy a Prius.
I'm with you on that. Can I get a little clarity on the numbers, though, Zach?
Yes.
I feel like I'm missing some information.
All right.
The added $5,000 of expense for the remainder of the year, that's if the person starts when?
Correct. Well, for the next 6 months.
Okay.
Yes.
So let's assume that the person's not going to start tomorrow. So the $5,000 isn't totally accurate. It's less, it's south of $5,000.
It's $10,000. What I did there was, right now we allocate a lot of money in our budget for this A2 on-call coverage.
Right.
That isn't going to that. We don't have that. So if we were to reallocate that chunk of money for this position, we would be $10,000 short annually.
If the person were hired today.
No, annually.
$10,000.
So the annual budget. Okay.
Yeah.
That includes the fringes or no?
No, it does not.
So it's $28,000.
So that would just the sat right exactly. Right, so I'm just counting salary there.
I guess from my perspective, and I wouldn't be opposed to hiring another person at all, but it would be helpful for me to see the total nut as opposed to just part of the nut, because it's just not complete information.
Sure.
So $5,000 means nothing.
I don't want this to come off as like me proposing this tonight.
He was responding to me, and I want to be sure that I clarify that I did not ask him for a benefit package, which we have a standard amount that should have been added in, and he was just responding to me with a salary adjustment, and so that was
right. And I guess I would caution us that. Yes. When the incomplete information is requested, it prompts the 20-minute conversation in this meeting that we've just had.
I know, and it is. But I'm taking responsibility because I was rushed. Oh my gosh!
All right, Zach, can we take this up next time?
The only thing I'd like to ask is, over the course of our last few meetings, has there been any outreach to any of the local volunteers that still might?
They're all on my roster.
I'm asking about that too. Please, I do go in and I do talk to him about that, doing outreach. So he is doing that.
Yeah, it's there's no leaf left unturned when it comes to trying to find.
Making sure he's checking that out. The poor thing is making calls. Now, on your software, again, I was rushed. Zach, could you just go over the software implementation plan?
Sure.
Moving ahead.
Before we get there, are we done with staffing, or does anybody else have anything to add to staffing? We all set?
Okay.
Wow. We agreed on something.
Silence, definitely.
All right, let's go on to staffing. I mean,
scheduling.
Let's go to equipment scheduling. Yes.
So the scheduling software we're using is a module within our patient care report software, and it's just absolutely broken. We're setting up this new system. Not only will it fix all those problems, it will handle a lot of things that we were doing manually before. So time off requests. It also has like a intranet type thing, so we can send out protocol updates, and it'll track that everybody's seeing these things. Also, part of this is it will integrate directly with the Harper's payroll system, which is what the town of Deerfield uses. I've had just preliminary discussions with the clerk's office now to see if this is something that they might be interested in utilizing. But it means that not only is it going to increase efficiency for us, it could also reduce the amount of work in the clerk's office in the town of Deerfield for entering all the payroll information as well.
Now, Zach, I just want you to make sure that we are hiring a new IT person.
No.
No, we are.
Oh, the tenant, no, okay. Look, I am not hiring anybody.
No. We are hiring. We have a new IT person.
Okay.
So let Pat Kroll know that, you know, have him look at this so we can get it to work properly. Okay, so you're not spending a lot of time on this.
Yeah, my primary goal is to fix our problems now as an added benefit. There's this potential laying there. So that was going to be a discussion that was in the next step.
But your software package that you're purchasing will come with some consulting services for implementation.
Yes,
soon.
Yes.
And ongoing, or does it end?
I mean, like, there's
is it a contract where if something goes wrong?
Yes. So there's ongoing technical support every month, and then we have an initial setup that we're doing right now. So they're doing all the back end stuff.
Just make sure he connects with our new person, because he's really, really good, and he's very practical and very let's get this done attitude. So we don't and user. He makes sure everybody understands how to use whatever we have. So he's good.
Love it.
I have a question, Zach.
Yeah.
Since is this to replace software that you currently have or using?
Yes.
And if so, I mean, if the ambulance has only been around for 3 years, how come it's so outdated so quickly?
It's not that it's outdated. It's that it doesn't do the job that we were hoping it would do. It's part of, so we have patient care reporting software. This was a scheduling module that the company just came out with that would integrate and backfill crew members and things like that. And it's just, it's not there yet. It's not mature, it's not robust, it doesn't do what we need to do. So we were hoping that it was going to work for us, but it just doesn't. So this is actually a system designed from the ground up for scheduling.
What's attractive about this and why I like this, Kip and Trevor, is because it takes the availability of our per diems and schedules that so that we have more opportunity to take advantage of them.
Per diems.
And then, so, you know, we want to make sure it
works. So instead of responding to a specific open shift, they can say ahead of time, I'm available on this day. So later on, when we get to that panic mode, where like we're 5 days out or a week out, we can see, oh, this person has already said that they're available. I'll call them first or something like that. Yeah. Right. Ian Campbell, it's that time of year again. Is going to be presenting us with a $3,000 gift. The ceremony is on December 19th. So previously this went to, for our department, personal protective equipment, so reflective vests and jackets for everybody and to identify people. We've gotten everybody up with equipment, so they're there with that. But I was polling the staff, and the consensus seems that like our radios are either have broken and haven't been replaced yet or are outdated and can't do some of the things that we'd like them to do. So I think we're probably going to look to utilize that money for communication equipment.
Zach, would you make sure you talk to John Pachork, because he's on Homeland Security Council on, you know, interoperability group, and he's also on the Franklin County one.
Yep.
And so he would have a lot of information on what, you know, what would be the best purchase.
Yeah, I feel good about that. In our new truck, I actually made sure that we spec'd radios that were basically future-proof. So we're looking towards the future. These radios not only work now and are good for that, but if they're already talking about this, the county switching to a new system, these radios are capable of doing that, so we won't have to spend any more money on that and stuff. So we're thinking ahead like that already. So.
I really appreciate that, because I can't stand it that we buy equipment and then it's outdated.
I know. Tell me about it. All right. Home stretch here, right? Great.
Well, I was just going to ask, when you talked about uniforms and stuff, I saw your high visibility stuff. Would some of that get go to that, or you're just going to use it for equipment?
I think right now we're just going to allocate it for equipment. The high visibility thing, so segueing into that, I try to promote this environment at South County EMS for the staff that if you have any ideas, you know, you work someplace else or you've seen something, you think some equipment will work operationally, bring it to me, make a case for it. I will hear it out. And this is one of those situations. So somebody was like, big proponent of safety. I hate putting on our high-vis vests when we're out on 91. I'm actually encouraged not to put it on because I'm focused on patients, stuff like that.
Sure.
And he said, what if we adopted the option to wear the high-visibility polo shirts, not in like police officers do when they're directing traffic on road details and things like that? And I said, make your case. you know, bring me all the information. Him and another person actually came, and they selected it, and it seemed like a no-brainer. So what we're going to be, what we've instituted is, it's another uniform option. So we're not paying for everybody to, like, you know, now here's your shirt or whatever. It's a uniform option within our uniform regs, that if that individual is working on duty on the ambulance and is likely to be in and around traffic, that they have the option of wearing this high visibility polo shirt. So as they go and they replace their uniforms, they wear out, things like that, this will be one of their options. So
that would only work 6 months of the year, though.
Well, they already all have jackets that are high visibility. So all of their winter jackets are high visibility. They don't have to worry about that. But, you know, a lot of times we crank the temperature in the back of the ambulance. A lot of times we don't wear jackets outside unless we're out there for a really long time.
Yeah.
Really just encouraging this culture of safety and promoting that stuff. So this is great. You won't miss us. All right, and then last little bit. Joe Markarian came by from FERCOG. Sat down with him a couple weeks ago. He's doing the whole kind of review and study on the budget process and stuff like that. So I gave him lots of information. That was a nice little meet. Turns out South Deerfield Fire District has been billing us last year's amounts, not this year's amounts, which is 50% of what they should be. So I've reached out to the South Deerfield Fire Chief, and he's aware of the situation. It seems just a clerical error on their part. The bills coming over were beyond amount. And Holly and Charlemagne, talking about regionalization, they approached me a couple years ago now out in Worcester at that intermunicipal conference, and thought that they were looking, and I just have, you know, kind of a off to the side conversation. They're looking to put something together and just wanted to have a conversation before they finalize something and put it out.
So they're looking for information on how our organization works, not becoming part of our organization.
Yes, correct. Yeah. So just like proofreading, what's our experience like? Is there something in here that stands out, like is going to...
And I had brought that up at our small town summits, at how well you guys have regionalized and our towns have done this, and because they were really struggling with what to do.
Yeah.
They were trying to find ways to get a service to work. So I'm glad they reached out.
You know, I can't say that I have an idea whether, you know, what's going to work for them, but I'm happy to share my experience, and if they can apply it, then...
Thank you for doing that.
Then that'd be great.
Yeah.
Thank you, Zach, for sharing for that meeting, because that was really nice.
Yeah.
Does anyone have any additional questions for Zach on his report, comments?
There was one thing. Zach, you know, I have to do all the paperwork, and I'm signing the warrant for the, we got the AEDs in. I know you're stressed with staff, but is there any way that you could do some training over the next few months?
Of whom?
Well, it's at the highway garage. It's at the library, the senior center, the town hall. Just if you could do, you know, spread it out. But whoever is at those locations, so somebody knows how to use the AEDs.
It would be my pleasure for South County to do it. I can't say I can find a second that one of us isn't already dedicated to something. But I will. I will.
Zachary, are you trained? As a trainer?
I am in various things. It depends on what specifically they're looking for, whether it's a certification from American Red Cross or just a familiarization thing.
We just want someone to go and say, this is, if someone's having a heart attack, this is how you use it.
Sure, that's well within my wheelhouse. Are all these people CPR certified? Is that...
Do you run CPR classes, or who does that?
The short answer is no. South County EMS does not do that. We don't have the staffing to. But we have members of South County EMS who are instructors. Who can.
So the other thing I was thinking of too is when we had talked about, you know, when we finally get everything up and running, we were doing outreach and stuff, and I kind of feel like that would be one of the things, if you were staffed enough to touch base at our high schools and the library and different things like that.
Zach, I don't want you to pay overtime.
Exactly.
This is not
but
an
just
overtime
as
situation.
You know, but it is smart to have, you know, to have people in town know what they're doing with it.
But I would love if you could see if there's any interest in CPR and you know, put a thing circulating, and maybe in all three of our towns, to see if there's interest to do some CPR.
That was pretty good, Trevor.
Just, you know, see if somebody can get around to these locations. And whoever is at the location that is around these AEDs, if they could just, if you could just give them a little, I mean, I'd be interested to see.
I would too.
You know, one of our selectmen's meetings, maybe you could meet us a few minutes before, like the tail end. If we come in at, you know, like at 6:15, can you just show us, you know, how to do some basic stuff?
Yeah, I would love for South County EMS to be doing this for everybody. Right. It's just a matter of finding the, yeah, but I would love to make this happen.
I know.
Keep it on your, so we can
thank you,
yeah. List.
Yeah. I'm not like saying
we may
tomorrow.
Need one after selectmen's yeah. meeting.
All right, sorry.
But that, are you
but
all
I
set
signed,
there?
Yeah, I signed, you know, I signed in the stuff and I was interested.
The workers have an AED if you can't use it.
Well, sure. We have brand new ones and they're different. So, you know, that's number one, sets me right off. So I need a room to post.
I understand.
Okay.
All right, Zach, thank you. Zach, I would say that your reports are.
Thank you.
Great. Some of our best,
yep.
most detailed reports that we get.
The minutes or the
we have reports.
Oh. Okay.
Well, I haven't got to the minutes yet. We're going to get there in a second. But I appreciate your director report. As I said, I think it's important that we include them with our minutes. I think it tells a story, and I think that the historical story is important. Just so the people out there understand some of the stuff that's going on with runs. There was 584 transports to date, and to date means from January 1st, 2016 to 10/31/2016. So it was actually 796 calls. There was 584 transports. Advanced life support was 470. Basic life support was 114. We had four intercepts, 144 refusals, and others were 64. Deerfield had 403 calls, Sunum 232, Whately 111, and Zach just run down some of the surrounding towns we have. Greenfield was 18, Turner's 8, Common 14, Amherst 3, and there's other 9 calls to additional towns. So we have a total run stack of, last year was total runs of 802, so we're right on tap to meet those numbers, right?
And exceed them. That 802 is for the entire 2015
Correct.
Calendar year. It's
yes.
not for the same time frame as you report on for 2016.
Correct. We still have 2 months left.
So we're going right way by.
Yeah.
Right.
So, and again, I just think it's important. Sometimes we, you know, we just want people to understand it's some of the numbers that we're seeing.
So, Zach, we still have capacity by having the impact shift, even if we get up over 1,000 calls, which is, say, a 20% increase.
We have, during that impact shift coverage, assuming that I am, so assuming that that person, we have coverage that day, and I am not in a meeting or doing something, we have extra capacity during that time, and we could accommodate about 1,200 calls.
Okay.
During that time period.
Right.
So
I just want to make sure. Okay.
Yep.
And we're still at 7 minutes, 7 seconds.
Yeah.
Just being.
Yeah, I mean, like, and that's, you aren't going to see that number fluctuate from, but we have enough data now that that's kind of our average,
right.
And it's going to take a big change in our operation to see that number.
And that includes all ambulances, not just day one.
Correct.
Right.
These are all ambulances
right.
to our primary coverage area.
Right.
So,
right.
If you pull out just A1, it's like 90% of our calls, our response times are within like high fives, low 6 minutes. So,
great.
Yeah.
Neat.
And every once in a while, there's some mighty a little bit close to average.
Well, the bridge is out, so you can't get there from here.
Kevin is working on it, though. It's going to be fixed.
Medcare and Greenfield are on automatic dispatch for ambulance calls to upper and lower roads in the town of Deerfield, since the Stillwater Bridge is out. On average, we do slightly less than one call a month to that section of town. So it's unlikely that anybody living up there will need an ambulance, and if you do, I can't imagine that you'll see much
change in your response time since they're on automatic dispatch, so.
Have you guys talked about that in your selectmen's meeting, the ambulance going to that portion?
Oh, yeah, no, and we had public meetings on it.
All right, so we don't need to address, if we had, I'd be more than happy to fill in everybody. You know, I think it's important, it was kind of happened right out of our last meeting, so. So we have, you guys are okay with the plan that's in effect right now?
Oh, absolutely, Zach came to the emergency meeting and.
You'll still get great staff and a great response time, it just might have a different name on the side of the ambulance, that's all.
All right, I just want to make sure you guys, if we want, we could address that now, you guys are happy, so.
Yeah, Zach had a plan, when we, you know, we had the meeting on Thursday and we were closing the bridge on Monday morning, and Zach came to the emergency meeting that was called in a few hours and had a sorted out plan.
Okay, good.
So we were very happy.
All right, good. That, well, again, that's what we're trying to do.
Yeah.
I'm just glad those big trucks that kept going over the bridge didn't cause any problems, so.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys are lucky.
Just in time.
I know, you guys are lucky, so. Zach had sent out a copy of the budget, does anybody have any questions about the budget in addition to the overtime that's being spent?
No, I just sorted it out.
Trevor?
I'm good.
Jonathan? Gary, all set? All right, so we'll go on the pass, we'll pass on the budget stuff. The minutes of October 20th, received the minutes, does anybody want any comments on the minutes? I'd entertain a motion to accept this presented.
Second.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded. Zach, your detail is amazing.
I was once told that the first time you're asked to do something, really screw it up bad, and you'll never be asked again, but.
You went to opposite.
All right, so.
You're in forever now.
We have a motion made and seconded and to accept the minutes of October 20th, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, we got 5-0 on that, Zach. Old business, discussion on old business first.
Well, we got lawyers have all agreed that everything is kosher, and Deerfield Academy has agreed to make a donation to meet the needs of the service, and they're willing to meet with Zach and who else wants input and come up with a building as soon as possible, I hope. I just finished getting off the phone with Keith Finan this afternoon, just a few minutes before I got down here, and he's absolutely fine.
Okay, what do we want to discussion, Jonathan?
Nothing.
Okay. How are we going to proceed?
Well, we feel pretty confident about the lease agreement that we had. Well, I guess, unless you have any other questions, I'd make a motion that we accept the lease agreement from South Deerfield on the new building.
I guess when I say nothing, I'm.
Well, can we finish the motion? We go back to the discussion?
It's in direct discussion, response to the motion.
Okay.
Right.
So we can get a second? Maybe we don't get a second?
Okay.
All right, go ahead.
I make a motion that we accept the lease agreement to move the South County EMS to the new facility at 88 Greenfield Road in South Deerfield.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, a motion made and seconded. Discussion.
I've got a lot of questions, but I don't want to belabor the point. I guess I'm still confused as to whether the payments are for rent or they are for, for lack of a better term, a stabilization account for a capital account for expenses incurred for maintenance.
Well, I'm hoping that the money will go into an account that will be for South County to to use towards maintenance of the building and potentially some expansion, because Deerfield Academy isn't going to build, I mean, it's going to build a space for our people and the three ambulances, but we had already talked about some other things, and so there's potential expansion issues already.
But my concern with And I believe the figure thrown about was $36,000.
Yes.
$36,000 over 20 years, 25 years, is a tremendous amount of money for maintenance and expansion, a tremendous amount of money. And unless we can line item where those expenses go, I struggle with the cost.
Well, I agree, or I should say, I speak differently than Carol. The $36,000 is going to be rent to the town of Deerfield. The town of Deerfield will assemble an account to address future maintenance of the building and or expansion.
Well, yeah, oh, we agree.
But
yeah,
those are two different things.
Yes.
They are two very different things.
But basically, the rent is going to stay the same, the $36,000 a year, and we can enter into a two-year lease agreement, a five-year lease agreement, a 20-year lease agreement. We have no plans on changing the rent amount. And it's to the benefit of every community. I mean, to Whately, whatever the cost would be, you're looking at basically paying $480 a month in rent for the next 20 years. It's pretty cheap. You know, and I think Sunderland's looking at, I don't know, how many papers here.
Oh, first for the numbers, accepted. Deerfield at the 36,000 would be $18,633 a year. Sunderland would be $11,329 and Whately would be $6,012.
No, Sunderland would be $960 a month.
So we're on the same page. So I just had Deerfield with $18,633, Sunderland 11,329, and Whately would be $6,012 a year.
A year. And I guess, where's the line item for how you came up with the $36,000?
It's just an amount that we thought was fair, that it would be financially responsible for the town of Deerfield, assuming that we had to pay for all of this, not knowing all of the costs going into the process, and that it was also substantially less money than we were currently paying, all of this. It's about almost half of what we're paying.
Well, 51 to 36. 51 is what we total pay right now, in total. I guess, and again, we are three towns working together to be treated equally. And I was not on the Board of Oversight back when Whately was taken to task in a not so kind way for putting out a figure that we did not defend with a line item budget. And in fact, we were told we were fiscally irresponsible for not putting out a line item budget. And it was the members of this Board of Oversight that made those comments, both in session and outside of session. And the comments were made by people not on the Board of Oversight with the same chapter and verse. And what we're being asked to accept is exactly what this Board of Oversight criticized Whately for doing. And then we responded with a detailed itemized line item of where the rent dollars were going, because nobody, and I understand this, wanted to be spending money that they didn't know, taxpayer money that they didn't know where it was going. And so by this motion, you're asking us to approve exactly what the board did not approve not too many months ago. Or it approved ultimately after the line items were provided. And I'm struggling that it doesn't strike me, and again, I get it, I wear the Whately hat, but it doesn't strike me that the three towns are being treated with equity. It strikes me that the three towns are being treated very differently. And that's not the way to run an organization with a very clear and relatively well put together IMA.
Well, since you're wearing your Whately hat, do do you see any way that you could come up with another solution where the Whately taxpayers would only pay $480 a month?
That's exactly not what I said, Kip.
I understand.
You're not responding to my concern.
Jonathan, I don't know what to say. We're on the Board of Oversight, and yes, we do wear two hats, but I feel you constantly try to blur this line. And what I'm saying to you is that as a Board of Oversight, we have a responsibility to find a permanent location for our enterprise. And there's a proposal that is less expensive for every community equally, right down the road. And I don't mean the location. It's, you know, I don't see what the problem is.
I guess.
I think that you're making a big deal out of nothing.
I'm not making a big deal out of that. But I do have to question if Deerfield Academy is gracious enough to put this building up at their expense, at no expense to the towns of Whately, Deerfield, and Sunderland. Where on earth is this money going? Even if it's only $600 or more, $6,000 a year, where on earth is $36,000 a year? And some of it's obviously a paper move in Deerfield, which is fine, which is the way it works. But where on earth is $36,000 a year going if there's no rent to pay? There's no bond to pay off. Where is it going? I think it's a fair question, and to belittle my question it shows that this isn't an equitable.
Well, here, to answer some of your questions, you know, maybe $2,000 to $3,000 a year will be for plowing the sidewalks. Maybe $2,000 or $3,000 a year will be for mowing the lawns and take care of the shrubs. 20 years down the road, $100,000 will go into the new roof. If we need another bay in the thing in 10 years and we're gonna have to spend $50,000 to add on to there, that's where it all goes. It was forward thinking about these types of expenses.
And
you want me to itemize every little thing.
You asked me to itemize every little thing.
Because you've never given us a number.
That's not true.
Let everybody just ratchet down. And let's have a nice discussion. I like the discussion how we're going so far. I think we have valid points.
I agree.
I think there are valid points on both sides. Let's just try to maintain that good discussion.
Can I just make a comment? I think what we had discussed, and we do have to set up some kind of thing, that the money can't end up in the general fund. This is for the EMS building. And what we're trying to do is, because we have such a hard time doing our capital projects, you know, finding the money ahead of time for capital projects, and we just can't afford to do any more debt exclusions and stuff like that. And so the whole idea here is that it would be nice if we could put a $100,000 roof on, but we just did the elementary school, and it costs almost more than the elementary school. So I have to tell you that this money will get sucked up to do roof replacements or in an addition. Jonathan, you know you were going to have to hire an architect and do all this kind of stuff to expand your library building. That takes a ton of money. When we go to expand this building, maybe we can get Deerfield to do it. But if we do it ourselves, then guess what? We're going to have to pay big bucks to add on to that, to add another bay. And maybe Kip thinks he can do it for 50, but, you know, that's just, to me, anytime the town does anything, you're always talking big bucks.
Okay, but over 20 years, what's $36,000 over 20 years? What is the total?
It's you know, $7,200.
So what?
$720,000
with no debt service.
Well, half of that money is Deerfield's anyways.
No, would you stop?
That's a separate, that's a very separate. Whoa.
But.
Whoa, stop.
Yeah.
I don't know how we do things on the other side of the river, but around here, if you wanna make a comment, you raise your hand.
Sorry.
Get recognized, okay? And again, it's okay to have discussion, it's okay to have different opinions. Let's just have it in a respectful manner, okay? Thank you.
But Kim is right, you're gonna have to have replaced pavement, you're gonna do plowing, you're gonna do some landscaping. I mean, we're hoping that playing fields will be incorporated in this because we want the entire property to be.
Playing fields?
Yes, in the back end.
But that's not part of this.
This is part of, no, this is part of the donation of Deerfield.
But it's not part of the 36,000.
Oh, no, no, but I'm just saying the, when they get the playing fields, you know, hopefully Keith will okay the playing fields. He's indicated he's willing to do this. So we'll have the whole property used, and it will be benefit, again, to kids, of whether it's Frontier or, you know, local sports or whatever, you know, the local team.
I don't see how it's germane, so the question is $36,000 a year.
No, but I'm saying that you have landscaping. We're not gonna have as much landscaping because we're hoping to have playing fields, but there will be some landscaping that will have to be done.
Of course.
And there'll be snow removal.
One second, please, Jeff.
Yes, just through observation here, listening to this for I don't know how many months now, but the 36, number one, is about half of what we were talking about previously. I understand your point, Jonathan, as far as how that can accumulate, but every town, if my understanding of what I've observed, always seems to come up short in their capital budgets. Every town seems to be scrambling when they try to take on a major project. So I understand what you're saying, Jonathan, as far as the amount accumulated over a 20-year period or whatever the case may be. But we have an oversight board here, and I would rather, as a taxpayer, see that money sitting in an account up front, knowing that the needs of the building and the property are going to be paid for as the need comes up. Also, as an oversight board, can't you review a lease agreement? You know, if you're doing 10-year period or whatever, or a 5-year period, or a 20-year period, or whatever the case may be, can't the oversight board go back and review? And if that money is being built up in that account, and the oversight board feels that it's too much, can there not be an adjustment made at that point?
Absolutely.
As far as lowering the rent, or even possibly determining that maybe some of that money goes back to the EMS budget to reduce the budget? Yeah, or another capital expense for the EMS. I don't understand that. Also, we're at a point here where we have a gift, a huge gift, that benefits all three towns, and we're arguing over it.
No.
You know, but
actually, we're not.
No, I'm just saying, as far as the 36.
Jeff, I don't really think that we are arguing.
All right. Well, we're discussing this.
Actually, it is a discussion, but your points are well taken. And I think it's important for the conversation to play out, and because I understand what, and my, I guess my question to Kip is, or Carolyn or Trevor, is there a reason why that, because my recommendation would be that we sit down and we have a group that's supposed to negotiate, mm-hmm. and my thing would, that group, I think it's Jonathan, myself, and Kip, would get together and we would talk about just what you and look at what a 5-year lease would look like, a 10-year lease if we wanted, mm-hmm. and talk about those specifics and talk about, are we seeing an escalation of what it comes, you know, maybe with the 36, maybe you're going to include heat, you know, maybe say it's going to, but that would be part of our negotiation strategy right now. And so I agree totally with what you're saying, and I think Jonathan was there. He was just saying it differently. I think Kip would understand what we're trying to say also. I think we do have to negotiate. I think we'd have to sit down just like and discuss what does that include? What's going to be included with that 36,000?
And so to just have a motion and a second that would adopt the two-page lease agreement, which, you know, lease agreements are pretty detailed, and lawyers go through them.
Oh yeah, I understand.
And negotiations have to happen, so for us to vote that motion.
Well, Jonathan, why don't you make a motion or amend that motion on contingency of negotiations?
I'm fine with it. I thought you wanted us to do that.
Just so you're aware, Jonathan, the lease agreement is 10 pages long. And with the exception of the dollar amount and the address, it's exactly what you already signed.
What did I already sign?
The lease agreement with the South Deerfield Fire District.
Well, I know. It was taken from that. It was no creativity involved there.
No. The lawyer just changed the names on it because she did the first one.
But we don't. But South Deerfield Fire District. I don't want to get them involved in the discussion because they've been great. They've been a great host. But we didn't get an itemized budget on that either. I wasn't on the board of oversight then. But I've signed a lot of leases in my life, Kip. I've signed a lot of agreements. When it comes down to money, you get itemization. Otherwise, your taxpayers are going to look at you and say, what are you doing?
I'd have to totally disagree with you, because what you're asking is, if you lease anything, you don't say to your landlord, what are you going to do with the money? Show me what you're going to do with that money. Are you going to buy a new car? Are you going to fix your office? Are you, you know, you're paying rent.
I want to see justification for the cost.
I don't get that at all. From this board's point of view, from what I believe this portion of it is, do we have the facility for our units to go there? What is the obligation our communities have to pay for this? And what are we going to get? What is done with that money is up to the landlord. This particular landlord is saying, we're going to put the majority of the money in an account to maintain this
building. Now it's just the majority of the money. See,
part of the money goes here. And
you don't say that, Kit. You change it.
I've never changed it, Jonathan. Never changed it. The rent was always going to be the same. What the landlord chooses to do with the money is the landlord's business. And I don't see any difference. Yes.
How did you feel about that when Waitley was asked about that?
If you think Waitley could come up with something, even
I didn't
Jonathan,
say that. I said when we gave a detailed budget, you were asking for the detailed budget too.
I just wanted to know the double cost. It wasn't a detailed budget. I said, what's
stop,
it going to cost?
Stop. Stop. I'm done.
And you're done. I don't know what to say.
Okay. Gary, thoughts? I'd like. Personally, I'd like to, and I understand why you put it there, but I'd like to put our team, our negotiating team still together to discuss this.
Absolutely.
And if I could, I'd like to amend the recommendation, and hopefully we can schedule this for the next month, and make sure Zach get a recommendation from Zach when he looks at the plans, so that he can make a recommendation to us, if that's okay.
Sure.
So I'd like to amend the motion. That the negotiating team meet the next week or two after Thanksgiving, and report back to this committee, and also have a recommendation from the director.
That's fine. Okay.
That's fine.
Do you want that motion?
Yes, please.
Okay, I make that motion.
Okay, we have a motion made. Second.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? 401, Zach. On negotiating team, Jonathan, you'll still be on it? I'd appreciate it.
Sure.
Kip?
Yeah.
All right, myself?
The only thing I'd like to add is if whoever's going to arrange this, try to give me more than a couple days in order.
We will. It just is a short notice last time.
So essentially the way it'll work is the three of us are going to sit down and sort of hash it out.
Correct.
What was the motion, I'm sorry, specifically?
Basically, we amended the motion.
Amended the motion.
And the motion is that we're going to, the motion was to enter into negotiations with Town of Deerfield.
With the negotiation team.
With the negotiation team.
and me to make a recommendation back to them.
We want the negotiation to make a recommendation on the monthly cost.
Yeah.
And the particulars of the contract, the lease contract, and we need from you, Zach. I don't want you involved in the lease agreement.
Yeah.
But I need you to talk with the representatives from the town of Deerfield on the housing, if it meets the requirements.
Sure.
What my understanding is, Jeff Galley will be the clerk of the works on this.
Okay.
And so Jeff from Deerfield Academy, and so he will be in touch with them.
Is that perfect? That'd be perfect.
You know, to get more information.
Okay?
Sure. Sounds good.
All right. Anything else?
And Dick would, Dick would facilitate the making sure that if you have any questions on stuff that you feel like you have a town rep, we're not supposed to be actively.
Yep.
Jeff, just quick question, with the holidays coming up, when will be the next oversight board meeting with the whole group here? Any ideas? What does the third Thursday of the month come up at? Do you know offhand?
It's the Thursday before Christmas, right?
It's Thursday before Christmas.
It'll be the 22nd.
When do you want to do?
I would do the 22nd.
The 22nd?
Can we do the week before by any chance?
We have a sewer rate committee meeting that night, the week before. A lot of people would like to attend.
There's five Thursdays in December.
Is there five Thursdays?
First, 8th, 15th, 22nd, 29th.
First?
8th. First, 8th, 15th.
No, 15th would be the third, that's the
29th?
I'll be out of town. I mean, a lot of people are going to be out of town that week.
Okay.
I would imagine.
No, that's a good point. You're right.
Is there anybody want to do it Tuesday that week, the 20th?
Would that be okay? Jonathan, the 20th?
I got it.
Here, you check your schedule also?
Okay.
You all set?
At this point, it's...
Is the 20th okay, Jonathan?
I think so.
Yes, sir.
I just want to clarify my comment before I leave. I just think that not saying it that way is maybe wrong, you know, but I think Deerfield wouldn't have come up with that number of rent and invested their part if they didn't think it was a fair number to invest back in the building.
Understood. And again, I'm just trying to, I want everybody to be heard and everybody to feel like they have an opportunity to speak as well. That's, and sometimes it's hard. Sometimes we understand emotions. The guy next to you, look at him, he's boiling inside.
Probably the last guy I'll ever see, right?
Yeah,
that's right.
I don't know if you'll see him or not.
20th okay, Jonathan?
That's fine.
Trevor?
Yep.
20th? Yep.
20th.
What time?
Six.
6 o'clock. And Bobby Holter will be back. All right. Zach, could you please post that with the town clerks?
Yes, Tuesday the 20th.
And Zach, are you available?
I will make myself available. How does that sound?
The answer that I would love to hear you say. Thank you. All right. So we have, that was old business. Any new business before the board?
How's the truck coming along? Do we have a date on that?
I saw the first pictures of bare chassis, just nice. Confirming where the paint line is going to fall. So it's coming along. Good. It's coming along.
So it's still February, though?
No change in that date. So
does that mean that, I mean, how's the, you know, your first ambulance, is that hanging in there, repair job?
Well, you don't want to jinx it, but yeah, it was really great. Yeah.
You got to go with
it. Yeah. In service, up and running. Yep.
All right.
Okay. Any other comments from Jeff?
Just very quickly, I'd like to thank the people that were involved with this for all their hard work and their effort. And I know at times it gets frustrating when you're trying to move things along. And the other thing too, with DA, I think they deserve a public thank you.
We will.
It's huge. It's,
we just finished making sure that this was totally mm-hmm. legal, and we had the Attorney General support and stuff like that.
Right.
But, you know, I just want to explain that this was not a sudden thing. I mean, this John Bajorek started this discussion well over 2 years ago. The problem was that you know, we had a donation, we requested a donation towards the Deerfield Elementary School roof, a substantial amount of money, you know, a couple hundred thousand dollars. You know, and they're paying it yearly over 20 years, so it's for them, it's not a huge amount, you know, it doesn't impact their budget, but it still was a very large gift. And also the fire district at the same time was asking for help with a, you know, the old Deerfield Fire District was asking for help for a fire engine. So, mm-hmm. you know, we were all at the table asking for, you know, big ticket items at, you know, that were kind of serious. And I have to say, if it wasn't for Kip mm-hmm. making the effort to actually do the nuts and bolts of a, you know, this is what the kind of design that we could live with, this is the kind of, you know, needs we need. If he hadn't actually calculated the cost of that down to this every nail and gone to Keith and said, this really isn't going to cost you that much money compared to what we as communities would have to put out, and we cannot afford another huge mm-hmm. debt exclusion, we'd still be talking about it. But it was a concerted effort of all of us beating on the doors and Deerfield Academy being very, very generous. And I mean, that's really, really important that people understand they actually do not have to do anything. And there is always a lot of complaints that, you know, there, you know, more and more stuff comes off the tax rolls and it costs us money and stuff. But I have to say, every time that I go there with my hat out, I usually end up with something. And it is mostly what I ask for always. And I know that happens consistently across the board, and you know, whether John Pachork has to go there for stuff, we need IT help, or we need, you know, heating help with the buildings. I mean, we've had terrible problems with the town hall. You know, the cool air conditioning and the heating.
This is just huge, I think, for all three communities.
Yes.
But
it's not just Deerfield, it's all three
communities. I mean, it has been a concerted effort, and it has been a long-term effort. This is not just so we could blink Waitley out of it. When we started talking about the service and needing a permanent space and realizing that we couldn't keep all the ambulances under one roof, this has been a problem for a long mm-hmm. time, since we started this service. And this, so we've been trying to solve it. Just when you are the person asking for money, it doesn't always happen in a timely manner, and you have to go through all the checks and balances and all their procedures as well to get okay. And so, I mean, we can't thank Deerfield Academy enough, because all our communities, this is a life safety issue, and we all have 24/7 paramedic service in under one roof pretty soon, and that is fantastic. I mean, that is a huge service for our communities, all three of our communities. So. It is a very generous gift.
Mm-hmm. I just want to, is that it, Jonathan, anything else?
Nothing.
I just wish to thank everybody for the dialogue tonight. It was good. I thought you guys did a good job. And actually, if you want to get good solutions, you should really have to do. All right, I'll entertain one final motion.
I make that motion.
I assume that was to adjourn.
Yeah. Yeah, motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
That's 5-0.